Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to Faith here at our Celebration Ministry Center. Whether you are worshiping with us online or in person, my name is Aaron Rosenau, one of the pastors here at Faith, and it is my privilege to welcome you to worship today. We're continuing a series that's called Life in the Kingdom. We're looking at the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew talks a lot about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. So we're talking about what that means, what it looks like today. And we're in Matthew chapter 15 today as we continue that series. Want to ask something special, just a special request for everyone who has not already filled out our online survey about fall programming. So we're looking at when do we start Sunday school and midweek school and change the schedule for Sunday worship. And so it'll be really helpful if you have not already filled out that survey that was mailed out to all of those who are on our mailing list this last week. And if you haven't filled that out, just follow that link. It's really easy and quick. Just a few questions to help us in planning for this fall. Also, next weekend is a Holy Communion celebration. So whether you are communing at home or here in person, if you're communing at home, you can make your own special space for worship and also prepare the bread and the wine. You can also pick up the small communion kits from the entryway at both of our ministry centers and have those communion kits ready for next weekend when you worship at home, if that is your preference. Last week we mentioned Comfort Dog Ministry. For the last couple years, we've been ramping up to that point when the Lutheran Church Charities is going to be giving us, well, they're not just giving us, but we've been working toward getting a comfort dog for the ministry here at Faith and in our community. In order to have that comfort dog given to our congregation, we need two very important volunteers, and they are called caregivers. They are two different homes who would open up to provide the dog, our comfort dog, with a home. So if you are interested in providing that kind of service to our church and community and serving as a caregiver, you can find more information on our website, faithfoxvalley.org/comfortdog. You can ask your questions there as well and get some more information. So we'd really love for a couple of people to step up in that important role of caregiver. Tonight, I want to acknowledge, we don't do this very often, but for the last 5 months, we have been providing our services online, which we had not done before. And that takes a lot of effort behind the scenes. So you might see Pastor Adam or Pastor Dan or myself up here in the front and some others who are in front of the camera, but there are a lot of people who are behind the camera as well. Those who are working our tech crew, sound, also the video, those who are troubleshooting behind the scenes during the week when something is just not going quite right and trying to get it all fixed. And I just want to give a great shout out to all those who are volunteers and on our staff who are doing just a great, great work and helping our congregation to stay together, our faith family to stay connected even when we can't be together in person. And when that means you're online, well, there are a lot of people who are making us up front look good because they're doing a lot of work. So thank you to our sound crew, our tech crew, and everybody else. I'm going to hand it over to the band, let you lead us in worship. Whether you are online or here in person, would you please stand as we begin with worship?
Bow down and worship him now. How great, how wonderful. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the try.
we turn our hearts to confession before the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
As members of Christ's body, the church, let us come before our Heavenly Father, confessing our sin and humbly asking for his forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed.
We have not loved you with our whole heart, soul, and strength.
Nor have we loved our neighbors as ourselves.
We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven.
We have held onto grudges and tore others down.
We have ignored your call to serve as Christ served us.
We have been selfish and stingy toward others.
Accept our confession, O Lord, for the things that we have done and the things that we have left undone.
Forgive us for our lack of faith, our lack of love, and our lack of generosity with what you have first provided to us. Accomplish in us the work of your salvation and help us to reflect your love and magnify your holy name. Amen.
St. Paul assures us in Ephesians 2, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It is by grace you have been saved. It's my privilege as one of your pastors to announce that good news to you once again, to assure you that you are forgiven in the blood of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. You are called to be our Father's own child. You are his. And as Jesus promises, nothing will ever be able to snatch you out of my Father's hands. That's God's assurance to you. My assurance is that you are forgiven. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. You may be seated as we continue our worship of the Lord.
Soul on fire.
Let us pray. Almighty God, it is by your grace that we live as your holy people, offering our faithful service to you and our neighbor in response to your extravagant love.
Help us to walk humbly and lovingly by faith, not by sight. May our good deeds of faith always be in response to your goodness and for the benefit of our neighbor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, it's time for a message for our children, especially. Those who are with us in worship can stay right where you are. And even if you are online, well, maybe you want to get a little bit closer and listen to Mrs. Lane as she has a special message for our children.
Well, hello, everyone. It's good to be back among you. I am thinking that a lot of you, when I say John 3:16, you know what verse that is, right? Is that a verse? How about we say that verse all together, all right? You say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. I want to talk about one important word from that verse, and that word is believes. That verse says that whoever believes in him, believes in Jesus, that means, has eternal life. But what does that mean to believe in Jesus? Or sometimes we say it a different way. What does it mean to have faith in Jesus? We know that God is the one who gives us faith. He gives that faith when we're baptized, and we know that God helps us to, he helps us and makes our that belief in him to grow and get stronger as we spend time with him. But still, what does it mean to believe in Jesus? What does that look like? I've got a little story that I thought I'd share here that I think will help us with that. And in this story, we have to do some pretending, all right? You have to pretend that I am a tightrope walker. So you really have to use your imagination, right? Okay, and you have to pretend that this rope that I have here, which I don't know if you can see, but there's a rope, and you have to pretend that it's up high, like up where those speakers are, okay? So I'm the tightrope walker, and here is the rope. And I get up there, I'm up there, and I take my first step. Ooh. I made it all the way across. Now you know that I am a tightrope walker, right? You know that about me, but you still don't believe in me. Let's see, for my next trick, I'm gonna take this chair and I'm gonna walk across this tightrope holding a chair. Here I go. Whoop, well, okay. I'm still there. All right, I made it. So now what do you know about me? You know that I'm a pretty good tightrope walker, right? And you know that I can walk on that rope even carrying a chair like that. But you still don't believe in me. There's another question I have for you. How many of you believe that I can walk across this rope holding a chair and there's a person sitting in the chair? Now, for the sake of this story, you all have to say yes. Yes. Okay, you believe that, huh? That's still not enough. That doesn't mean that you believe in me, because there's one more question. I bet some of you know what the question is. Will you come and sit in this chair as I carry the chair and walk across on this tightrope? And how you answer that question is determines on whether or not you believe in me or not. If you say yes, You do believe in me. That means you trust me. You're trusting me with your life as I carry you across way up high on that rope. Okay, believing in Jesus is kind of like that. If we believe in Jesus, first of all, it means that we know who Jesus is and we know the things that he's done for us. We know all of those promises that he gives us. And we know that Jesus and all those things that he did for us, that those are real. It's not a made-up story and it's not pretend. But knowing that Jesus is real doesn't mean that we believe in him. Believing in him means that we trust him. It means that we get in that chair with Jesus as the tightrope walker. It means that we put our whole selves into Jesus' care. We trust him, and our whole lives, our whole selves, our lives and our needs and our cares are all put on Jesus, and he carries us. So believing in Jesus means that we pray to Jesus, and we know and we trust that he hears our prayers and that he answers them in the way that's best for everybody. Believing in Jesus means that we trust that he's with us always in the good times and the bad times. And here's the biggie. Believing in Jesus means that we take all of those sins, all of our sins, that's all those bad things that we do, the things that we do that aren't part of God's plan for us, the things that we do that separate us from God. We take all of those sins and we give them to Jesus, knowing and trusting that he died on the cross and rose again to take those sins away and to forgive us. Believing in Jesus means that we know and trust that he is the only way for us to be forgiven and to have eternal life. Now, I am not so sure that I would believe in a tightrope walker who says they could carry me across on a tightrope. I'm not so sure about that. And my guess is most of you aren't so sure about that either. But I am sure about Jesus. I am sure that as we believe in him, as we know him and trust him, that our sins are forgiven and that he is already preparing us for eternal life, just like that John 3:16 says, whoever believes in him will have eternal life. How about we have a prayer? I'll speak the words and you can repeat them after me. Dear Jesus, thank you that we can trust in you. Help us to believe in you always. Bring us safely to eternal life with you. Amen. We turn now to our scripture readings, and the first reading is from Paul's letter to the Galatians, Galatians chapter 3, verses 1 through 14. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? So again I ask, does God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by your believing what you heard? So also Abraham believed God and was credited to him as righteousness. Understand, then, that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announced the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, as it is written, Cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God, because the righteous will live by faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says, the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Now I ask that you would stand and we honor Jesus as we hear the gospel reading, the very actions and words of Jesus from Matthew chapter 15. Then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem and asked, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat." Jesus replied, "And why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? For God said, 'Honor your father and mother,' and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. But you say that if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is devoted to God, they are not to honor their mother or father with it. Thus, you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules." Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen and understand. What goes into someone's mouth does not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth, that is what defiles them." Then the disciples came to him and asked, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this?" Jesus replied, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them. They are blind guides. If the blind lead the blind, both will fall into a pit." Peter said, "Explain the parable to us." "Are you still so dull?" Jesus asked them. "Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart, and these defile them. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what defile a person. But eating with unwashed hands does not defile them." Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not say a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. Jesus replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. This is the gospel of the Lord. Now we join with the church all across the world, believers of all time and all places, in these words of the Apostles' Creed. It's our way of making a statement of what we believe in, our triune God. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Earlier this week, I had a brief but terrifying flashback to my childhood. You ever had this? Where a particular smell or a sound, something you see in an instant takes you back to some experience in your past? For me this week, it was the sight of a group of kids picking teams for a game. Yes, there are actually kids gathered together, even during COVID, to play. And they had selected their two captains, and they were picking their teams. Now, when I was a kid, I wasn't exactly the worst choice for your team. Wasn't exactly the best choice for your team. I was pretty scrawny, so a stiff breeze would blow me over. I wasn't exactly offensive line material, if you know what I mean. But I wasn't completely uncoordinated, so usually I was somewhere right in the middle of the draft. But still, I really hated those selections, because the longer you went without getting picked, the worse you felt. And I always felt horrible for those kids who were the last picked. No one wants to be the last. And no one wants to be on the outside looking in either. That did happen to me once, actually. 21 boys tried out for my middle school baseball team. 21. 18 were picked. That means 3 were cut, including myself. And one of 3 that did not make the team. It was awful. No one wants to be left out. No one wants to be on the outside. But I want to consider what it means to be on the inside or on the outside as we continue our series on the Gospel of Matthew called Life in the Kingdom. We've been exploring the reality, the truth that is revealed to us in the Bible, that Jesus Christ is Lord and King. That in Christ, God came to the earth to rule as king. And throughout Matthew's gospel, Jesus talks a lot about the kingdom. So he says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Just a few weeks ago, we talked about this one chapter, Matthew 13, where Jesus tells 8 parables. 6 of them, Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, for example. Well, now in Matthew 15, which we're looking at today, we're halfway through Matthew's gospel. And we all of a sudden have this jarring, shocking sequence in which Jesus says some stuff about who's in and who's out. Who's in, who's out. And I say it's jarring and shocking because really the whole chapter is a little strange. On the one hand, you have this group of religious leaders who have come from Jerusalem, probably traveled several days from the south in Jerusalem up to Galilee in the north to confront Jesus. And there's this whole business about what truly makes someone unclean. And the key verse is in verse 11. Jesus says, "It's not what goes into someone's mouth that makes a person unclean, but what comes out of the mouth." And he goes on, verses 17 through 20, to say that what goes into the mouth goes back out of the body. Literally, he says, into the latrine. Okay? It goes back out of the body, to be quite blunt. But what comes out of the mouth comes from the heart. And so if you really want to know what somebody is about, what comes out of their mouth is really coming out of who they truly are. It's in their heart. And Jesus actually lists a few of those things that mark people who are sinful. The heart that's sinful brings out murder and adultery and sexual immorality and theft and false testimony and slander. So that's one interaction. And on the other hand, you have this interaction with this woman who literally comes from the other direction than the religious leaders. They came from the south in Jerusalem. She comes from the north in Tyre and Sidon. So when Jesus goes into that region, she comes to him. But she's opposite the religious leaders for a much bigger reason. And that is, she's not a Jew. She's not the in crowd. She's not one of those who is the chosen nation of Israel. And that's okay. You know, those of us who know the story and we know that Jesus has come for the entire world, not just for the chosen people of Israel, not a shocker. But then Jesus says some pretty strange stuff, right? There's this woman who comes and she has a daughter who wants to be freed from a demon. And Jesus can do this. He can cast out the demon. He's done it before, more than once. And so we expect that Jesus is going to have compassion like he always does, except that's not what he does. He says something really odd. It's not right, he says, to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Does this sound strange to you? He just called her a dog. If we were in our culture today and Jesus said this and it got out, he would be canceled just like that. Right? See what I mean by a jarring and shocking sequence here? Just when you thought you knew what Jesus would say, just when you thought you knew what God would do, he does something different. Just when you thought you knew what God would do, you know that that's actually the whole point. The whole point is that God changes things up as he wills. And this happens all through the Gospel of Matthew, through the whole Bible, really, everywhere. God is doing things that you don't expect, but specifically in Matthew, in the kingdom of God, things are just not what you would expect. So most people would expect that it's the strong and it's the powerful who conquer the earth. They take territory. But then Jesus comes along and he says, blessed are the meek. The meek will inherit the earth. And even Jesus' disciples, they think they've got it figured out, and they have this expectation. James and John, two of the disciples, come to Jesus, and they think that he's going to pick his two favorite, one to sit on his right and the other at his left when he comes into his kingdom. And Jesus says, oh, no, 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 no. There will be two criminals instead, one at his right and the other at his left, when he is crowned as king. And when he's crowned as king, it's not a crown of gold, it's a crown of thorns. And his throne is a cross. And when we look at this, we think, well, we expect him to come in kingly glory. The people that were there at the time expect him to come in kingly glory. But no, he suffers and he dies. It looks like defeat. But it's victory. It's victory over sin. See, when people think they know what God is doing and what God is going to do, they find out that God's ways are not our ways. God works in ways we just don't expect. And God even said this, Isaiah 55, your thoughts are not my thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. And that goes for who's in and who's out as well. Who's in the kingdom, who's outside the kingdom. The Pharisees and the other religious leaders, they came from Jerusalem to confront Jesus, and they knew, right? They knew that they were inside the kingdom. They considered themselves as the chosen, God's team, the winning team. And they considered themselves on the winning team because of how they lived their lives. They could point to their upright lives that marked their status. They could they could point to how good they were by comparison to those who were on the outside. And in their view, Jesus claimed to be inside, but he didn't follow all the rules, which is why the confrontation, why they traveled for days to come to confront him. Because they asked, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? Now go another step in the view of the Pharisees. This foreign woman that comes to Jesus, well, in their view, she's not a Jew. She's definitely on the outside. She doesn't even know the customs, much less follow them. So she's out. But God doesn't work the way we expect, and especially doesn't work the way the Pharisees expected. Here's the bottom line. Just cut to the chase. You are in not because of good things you do. You are in not because of your good life. You are in because of faith. You are in because of faith. At least as Matthew describes this and presents it to us, the kingdom is this wholesale, massive reversal of who's in and who's out. Jesus turns it all inside out. So again, this is true all over the Gospel of Matthew. So who are the first ones to come to worship baby Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew? In the Gospel of Matthew, who are the first to come to worship baby Jesus? It's foreigners, magi from the east. They're not Jewish people. The religious leaders don't come to worship Jesus. It's foreigners who come to worship Jesus. They bring their gifts and bow down to him. Who is the very first one in the Gospel of Matthew to express faith in Jesus? The first one. It's in Matthew chapter 8. Another foreigner, a Roman centurion, someone who's not a Jew, but living there and there as a part of the Roman army. He expresses faith in Jesus. And Jesus actually says that this is Matthew chapter 8. I tell you the truth, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. In fact, everyone in Israel, everyone in this story, including Jesus' disciples, they are described by Jesus at best as those with little faith. All through the Gospel of Matthew, the only people who express faith in Jesus are those on the outside. Tax collectors, prostitutes, foreigners, like this woman in our story, Matthew 15, whose daughter is demon-possessed. What does Jesus ultimately say to her? Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. It's all inside out. The religious crowd who thinks they're on the inside are on the outside, and those who are supposed to be on the outside are on the inside. It's as if Jesus has gone to those who are usually picked last, and he picks them first. He says, you are my team. Now, I encourage you this week, just do this sometime. Open up the Gospel of Matthew. There are 7 days in the week. There are 28 chapters of Matthew. 4 chapters a day. Just read through the whole chapter, the whole book of Matthew. You don't have to look at every detail. You don't have to understand every detail, but just read through it with an eye toward who's in, who's out. And you'll see this pattern over and over where those who think they're in are out and those who think they're out are in. Just over and over. God does not do what people expect. He turns it inside out and upside down. Now, I'm convinced that Matthew tells these two stories back to back. The Pharisees and the religious leaders coming to Jesus, and this woman with a demon-possessed daughter coming to Jesus. Stories back to back so that he can show the contrast between them. Remember, it's not what goes into someone's mouth that makes them unclean, but what comes out of the mouth. What comes out of the mouth of the Pharisees is accusation, right? It's accusing. It's murder and false testimony and slander. what comes out of the mouth of this woman? An expression of faith. An expression that she trusts the only one who could save her daughter and save her. Now, by the way, why does Jesus call this woman a dog when she first comes for help? I mean, this does not sound like the Jesus we know, does it? It sounds like a put down. It sounds demeaning. It doesn't feel right knowing Jesus. I think that if you read the whole story, what's going on is that Jesus is actually using a rhetorical device. He calls her a dog not because he believes she is worth less, not because he's insulting her, but because he knows that is in the heart of the people of Israel that time. That anybody who's a foreigner, anyone who's on the outside, is worth less. So he uses this derogatory term as a rhetorical device to actually get her to express the faith that she's already demonstrating by coming to him, to express this faith. So this apparent brushback by Jesus toward this woman actually is met by her faith when she still stands up. She's not deterred. She's not hindered. She says, even the dogs eat crumbs that fall from the master's table. So the faith that's in her heart is actually coming out of her mouth. Romans chapter 10, Paul says, it is with the heart that we believe and are justified. It's with the mouth that we confess and are saved. So Jesus actually in this moment draws that faith out so she can say it with her mouth. He does it in a way that we don't expect. But then again, that's how God rolls. He does a lot of things we don't expect. So Jesus allows her faith actually to shine brighter in this moment by pulling that faith out of her to be able to say it. Her eyes are on Jesus. It's obvious. I have some friends who just over a year ago adopted a little girl from China when she was 7 years old. It was considered a special needs adoption because partly she was already 7 years old, and most people who are adopting infants. But it's also, she probably was seven and still in the orphanage because she is also hard of hearing and has some other medical issues. When they went to China during the adoption process, they received their new little girl. And they took her to the hotel in the same city where the orphanage was. But they were encouraged that part of the transition, it would be a good idea to bring her back into the orphanage before they fully adopted her and left China, to actually bring her back into the orphanage to spend some time playing where in an environment that she was comfortable with. But they said that for little Mia, being back in the orphanage was actually traumatic. She was clinging to her new mom the whole time. She had no desire to see them walk out the door and leave her behind. She would not let go. And they brought her back to the United States, and she is fully a part of their family now. She spent 7 years of her life desperately in need of a family. That's where she is, this loving, beautiful family. And in that new environment where she is loved and treasured, she is the sweetest, smiliest, most talkative little 8-year-old. You can hardly understand anything she says, but she is just a chatterbox. She just loves where she is because the joy of being chosen just comes out. It's undeniable. You see it every moment. Peter says, once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Paul says, like the rest, we were all by nature deserving of wrath on the outside. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. Titus chapter 3, Paul says he saved us not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. When we were on the outside, he called us in to be his own. Inside out, outside in. And you are in by faith. Amen. In our worship, as a response of our faith, in response to all that God has given to us, we take a moment to receive our offerings. I know we're receiving offerings in a very different way these days. Nonetheless, this is a great opportunity for us to recognize that God has poured out his love and grace. He has called us to be his very own. And so with all that he has entrusted to us, we give back a portion of that for the work of his kingdom here and around the world.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe.
Gathered now in the name of Jesus, let us turn to our gracious Father in heaven and lift up our prayers in confidence that he hears us and answers us according to his will. Abba, Father, you strengthen our faith by using the little things to nurture our integrity, and we in turn reveal our integrity in the small, unseen, and unnoticed acts.
Jesus once said, "Whoever is faithful in small matters will be faithful in large ones, and whoever is dishonest in small matters will be dishonest in large ones."
Lord, we thank you for the gift of faith. We thank you for walking with us and leading us to know you and to trust you. And we ask that you would grow us, Lord. Grow us to see you and to follow you more and more in big ways and in small ways. Abba, Father, you strengthen our faith by using our talents to nurture our unselfishness, because our talents are not for our own benefit, but given to us to make the world a better place.
Martin Luther once said, "God does not desire the Christian to live for himself. Cursed is the life that lives for self. For all that one lives after he is a Christian, he lives for others."
You have blessed us, Father, with talents, with gifts, with things that we can do well. And we thank you for that great array of gifts given throughout your church. Gifts of music, of teaching, gifts of compassion, and friendliness, and caring hearts and helping hands. We ask that you would lead us to recognize our gifts and to use them in ways that build up people. Give us faithfulness and humility to share our talents in service to others. Abba, Father, you strengthen our faith by using tough times to teach us persistence, because real growth and faithfulness comes in persistence through the pain.
St. Paul once said, "Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day, for our present troubles are quite small, and they won't last very long, but they will produce for us an immeasurably great glory that will last forever."
You know, Lord, you know about our world. You know about the disease that's causing death and fear. You know about the injustice and the judgment and the discord and the distrust because of our varied views on things. You know about the explosions and the wars and the accidents, and you know about all the personal hardships that each of us is experiencing right at this moment. Lord, we ask that you would bring healing and peace and solutions to all our problems. Give us hope to see beyond the hardships and use those problems and hardships to grow our faith, to strengthen our resolve and to trust you more. Abba, Father, you strengthen our faith by using shortages to test our generosity, staying out of debt, investing wisely, giving liberally, and sharing generously. These are what you use to build your kingdom and build our faith.
Jesus once said, "Use worldly wealth to benefit others and to make friends for eternity. In this way, your generosity stores up a reward for you in heaven."
Father, you are the giver of all things, and we thank you for the many material blessings you give us, house and home and food and drink, clothes and shoes, employment and means of making a living. You are so generous in giving all that we need, especially in what we need in order to be your children, our forgiveness. As we experience your generosity, Lord, lead us to be generous too. Lead us to give cheerfully and liberally from hearts filled with gratitude to you. Abba, Father, you strengthen our faith by using our faith to build the faith of others. Though we are imperfect and flawed, we only need to be one step ahead to mentor and disciple others in their faith journey.
St. Paul once said, "The things you've learned from me in the presence of many witnesses, you are to entrust to other faithful people who will also be qualified to pass it on to others."
Lord, you have given us a mission to bring all people to believe in your saving grace. Help us with that mission, Lord. Give us strong faith and boldness to share Jesus with others. Guide our actions and give us the words wherever we might be that others can see Jesus through us. Abba, Father, grant your strength to those who are suffering from illness and recovering from surgery. Bless them with healing and well-being. Here in our faith family, we pray especially for Judy Kassler, who is going to be having surgery. We pray for Tom and Jan Thompson's grandson, who begins cancer treatment this week. And we pray for little Emma Krieger as she continues on her long road to recovery. According to your good and gracious will,
grant healing to the sick, comfort to the discontent, and hope to the fearful.
Abba, Father, it was your idea that men and women be joined in marriage to form families. We ask your blessing on two young couples as they begin their life together this coming week. We ask that you be with Rachel Carl and Kyle Medlin, and also Kristen Hall and Tyler Stumpf. Grow their love for each other and for you, and give them joy as they serve each other and as together they serve you. Abba, Father, we know that you know our needs even before we ask, but we take this time now for each of us personally to bring our needs before you. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your great mercy and compassion through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And together we join in the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.